Kia ora, I always wanted to start my YouTube career by introducing myself as Marty, first time tuber, long time goober. But we're 12 videos deep so far, so it looks like we're a bit late for that one. But what we can say is what we have here is a Frewza F18 hardtop made by the gang down in Invercargill. And we have currently got 491 hours, I believe, on the clock. Originally, I wanted to do a 100 hour boat review, but 100 hours has gone past. Evan's got a fish on in a place where I never even thought we'd get a fish. And yeah, so here we go on our boat review. There's an old saying in the building industry, taught to me by a grumpy old builder called Barry years ago, and it is, the numbers don't lie. Now, in the case of this boat, we've owned it for 3 years and 1 day, and we've got 490.4 hours on it, so we're 10 shy of the 500, but we're close enough. Now, if you do the maths on those numbers, it gives us a runtime of 29.5 minutes per day for every day that we've owned the boat. So the boat has done some fishing, the boat has been around. The boat goes across Cook Strait, the boat goes to Waihau Bay, the boat fishes off the Wairarapa, the boat fishes off Kapiti. We go to Derville, if we can get there, we go there. So this boat has been around. Now, I got a mate, Marky, and I told him, mate, you got 100 hours to get yourself on this boat. And he still hasn't come. So I was over there the other week. Oh, Jesus, we've got another fish hooked up there. And I said, Marky, we're up to 489. I can't keep lifting this number, mate. I can't keep lifting this number. He watched a few of the videos. He got super excited and he said, Marty, I'm there. I'm there tomorrow. You can count on me, Marty. Got the text message in the morning. Sorry, bro, can't make it. But we're not lifting that anymore, Mark. You got 10 hours to front up, mate. I got interested in southern bluefin tuna. I was on the internet drunk one night, and the next day I woke up in possession of two big 50 wides and a whole lot of marlin lures and no idea how I was going to pay for it, let alone go fishing with it. I took a trip up to Waihau Bay with my little plastic Mac 360. I got up there was 100 kg tuna hanging up. I had a look around, I spoke to a few blokes, I took in the whole situation and I learned one simple lesson from that, and that was real men, real fish, real boats. So I went home and I put in the order. I went and looked at a 6.1 bar crusher. I think old Phil from KP Marine, he was convinced I was just some tire kicker and he wouldn't see me again. I went away, had a look around, and ended up ordering this boat, the Frewza, and I just ordered the basic model. You know, that was about all I could afford. How I was going to get a motor for the thing, absolutely no idea. So anyway, by some miracle, we managed to pay for it all. We were working here, we were working there, we were going bloody hard. Then we went into lockdown, probably about the first lockdown, and that was probably 2 weeks before the boat would have been finished. So that was a bit of a bugger. Would I say I'd been frustrated at times during the build? Maybe, maybe not. Would I say I showed up in Invercargill a day early, stoned, in a pair of ripped jeans to pick up the boat? Maybe, maybe not. Would I say the lady in the office at Frewza looked at me quite rather condescendingly, I thought, and said, can I help you with something, sir? Maybe, maybe not. And to that particular question, I replied, yes, I think you can. I think you might have something of mine. Yeah. Now, I'm a guy who never in a million years ever dreamed he would ever own a boat like this. I spent 7 years in a plastic Mac 360 prior to this one. So I drove down to the factory. I got there a day early and I went in there and, you know, it was mind-blowing. It really was. I met the blokes that built it and they were pretty awesome fellas. Met Brendan, you know, he was pretty awesome. And then I actually asked one of the blokes, what's there to do around here? And he just said to me, mate, you're an Invercargill. It's a shithole. Nothing. So I ended up going for a drive to Milford Sound for the night. I would have passed about 5 cars on the road because we were 2 or 3 weeks after that first lockdown ended. And I ended up camping the night in Deer Flat in beautiful, splendid isolation. I was surrounded by a glacial moraine, or whatever you want to call it. I had the hillbilly stove going with me, had that cranked up. Yeah, and had a nice night camping, and then got up the next morning and headed back to Invercargill. I will just say, when I got up in the morning, I just about run over a massive whoppity hind standing in the middle of the road on Milford Road, which was pretty cool. And then we got back to Invercargill, went down the factory. I thought there was going to be some sort of official, you know, handover ceremony sort of thing, but you know, Invercargill was the land of the southern man, and true to form, here's your boat, fuck off. So I hooked up the boat and started driving. And one thing I did notice in Invercargill, when you're towing a brand new hardtop, even with an L300, no one even looks at you sideways. You're nothing. But, it took me like 2 days, it took me a day, I think, just to get out of Otago, because every lay down bay I pulled into, I would get out, I'd walk around, oogling the hell of it. It was truly a magnificent looking beast. There was only 2 things that I could fault with it at that stage. There was a tiny scratch up here on the gun, on the side there. I mean, that's nothing. I mean, you know, look at it now. And one of the rear stanchions, just behind you there even, ever so slightly on the piss. And it's only because I'm a builder that I picked that up. And, you know, like my brother would say to me, Marty, if the biggest problem you got in this world is that your right rear stanchion is slightly out of plumb, have you actually got any problems? Good call. So we got this boat back to Wellington in one piece. Like I say, we didn't know how we were going to get a motor, and then I seen Suzuki had a 36-month, 1.99% no-deposit deal going. Boom, that was us. Phil from KP Marine, they fitted this motor up. It's a Suzuki 140. It's particularly awesome. It's actually paid for now on account of our 36 months have gone by. So he fitted that up, and it wasn't long till we were off to do some fishing, and I'm pretty sure this boat's second ever dunk in the water was Waihau Bay. And on that particular morning on Waihau Bay, we hooked up a monster southern bluefin tuna. We caught an albacore about 5 or 10 minutes before that, and just to demonstrate that, boy, did we have no idea what we were doing. All the gear and no idea. We stood around, had an albacore tuna photo shoot, left poor old Huppy to try and deal with this big tuna on its own, and we lost it. We let it get straight under the boat, which was stupid. A bit of a lesson learnt there. Fishing, and particularly big game fishing, is a learning curve. So KP Marine, they fitted the engine up and did all the bizzo for that. Me and my son, we did the whole fit out ourselves. The very first thing I did was pull these ridiculous looking chipboard screws that it had in the dash and replace them with these really nice little dome heads, which I thought made it look a little bit tougher. We put a radio in up here. Unfortunately, and that is number one on my list, I don't think I brought a big enough antenna. Not a problem that I usually have, but in the case of the boat, the aerial's just not quite big enough. We're going to get a new one of those. We put on a Simrad Go 7, which we're going to talk about again in a minute. The interior light. Now, the interior light doesn't work anymore. It's shat itself. And if we're going to talk about things shitting themselves, I get it. I don't like saying anything bad to anyone about anything. But my main gripes with this boat are the factory fitted extras. Right. So this seat here, it's a whatever, up and down gas powered seat. And it crapped itself pretty shortly. I rung Frewza, weren't really interested. I actually ended up ringing the number of a bloke on the thing. I took the seat off, and he was real helpful, and he said, send him some information and he'll sort it out. Bit of procrastinating on my half. I've never quite got around to doing it. So, that's cool. We'll get that fixed one day, but it was nice having your seat going up and down. Now, the thing I hate the most, the window. Oh my God. Right, so this nut and bolt fell out pretty early in the piece. And the problem with this window, the problem that I have, as much as I love cruising along, opening my window on my hardtop, your head doesn't fit out of it. And it'd be bloody nice to be able to get your head out of it. I can only just get my hand, let alone my head. Because one problem you have with hardtop boats, when it's dark, you cannot see. It doesn't matter what you're doing. Because of the window and that. So it would be really nice if you could just get your head out that window. We've got a nice big Narva spotlight on the roof, so your vision, that would help a lot. I don't like that. I don't like the fact there's no sliding window. Our windscreen wiper, not that long ago, it just fell off. Heading out at Waihau Bay one morning, and she just fell off and slid straight on into Davy Jones's locker. We did have a minute or two where we could have grabbed it, but we were too slow and too lazy. So that went, and this is a cheap one, and it's really rubbish actually. It does that. So we only got the sliding window and the window wiper on one side of the boat. And to save money, and the other thing I've learned is that the last thing you want is to be giving your passenger or your co-captain a sliding window and their own windscreen wiper. You start doing that sort of stuff for them and they all decide that they're the captain now. I think what you'd actually be better off doing is getting one of those little kids car toy set things, like you put next to mum in the car, and they could just sit here next to you and have all the fun they wanted. Know about the handling and performance of this boat, well, not quite the right day for it because we've got a stunningly flat day in Wellington Harbour today, but let me tell you, we've got 6 Cook Strait crossings under our belt. God knows how many days of trolling up at Waihau Bay, at least a dozen. The Wairarapa coast, even the Cup of Tea coast, it doesn't actually get all that rough out there. But, it performs faultlessly. I can't ever remember ever feeling in danger or in trouble in this boat. And I must say, the thing I've learned is, generally, the only trouble you ever have with your boat is when you hook it up to someone else's tow vehicle. And that is pretty much true, unless you do something stupid out on the water, of course. This little thing here, we bent this once, and sort of straightened it up. Lesson to be learnt from that one. Don't leave your craft tied up to a wharf or a jetty for an extended period of time without checking your rope. The only other bit of damage that we've got on it, around here, and I'm embarrassed. This is embarrassing. My mate, the captain Wayno. Twitch, 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 twitch. We have a big dent in the side of this boat, and that dent got there. How did that dent get there? Hooking it up to another man's tow vehicle, that's how that dent got there. I mean, I shouldn't say it. I mean, God bless you, Wayno, I love you, but you're just you're a paradox, mate. How you fell asleep driving up a steep, windy hill towing my $70,000 Pride and Joy, we'll never know. I'm just glad you didn't kill yourself and my brother. And that is the only real flaw in this machine after 500 odd hours of use. Wayno, he is a true paradox, my mate Wayno. Without Wayno, I wouldn't have the boat. And with Wayno, I might have got a southern bluefin tuna on board quite a bit quicker than I did. I approach my big game fishing. I have an ethos that I use to approach my big game fishing. It's one word. Aretha Franklin wrote a song about it. Even the cameraman here, it's in his favourite movie, R-E-S-P-E-C-T. Respect. Respect for the sea, respect for the fish, respect for the land, respect for the people, and respect for all the other fishermen just trying to do what you're doing. You know, you don't go tailgating someone's 225 horsepower Evinrude 1 metre away on your way to Waihau Bay. Well, you do that if you want to hook up to 7 albacore and no southern bluefin tuna. I firmly believe you tick all those other boxes, put yourself out there, and you might have a chance. Even if it is on someone else's boat. Hey, JJ. Rant over. But while we're here, we'll do a quick walk around of the trailer and the boat on the trailer. I don't know if you just saw then how easy and how effortless it was to get on the trailer. That's fantastic. Well, I was just gonna quickly start at the front and work my way to the back. Tow hitch, fine. Jockey wheel, we're on our second one of those. But you know, you launch on beaches all the time. I reckon it doesn't matter how much grease and oil you put on it, you're gonna do a jockey wheel every year, every 2 years. The winch, we're on to our second winch. The first winch cracked out, and I rung Mr. Mudgeway of Mudgeway's Trailers, and straight away he sent me up a new winch. He also sent me a return prepaid postage courier bag for the old one, and I have to apologise to you, Mr. Mudgeway. I never sent it, but the reality was, as a child, I was beaten for not putting stuff in the post when I was supposed to. And you know, old habits die hard. So sorry about that one, Mr. Mudgeway. this V nook. Now, when I first started boating, I was actually told by Phil in the boat shop, you're more likely going to have damage to your boat or your trailer, well, obviously your trailer, on the land, not out to sea, and that certainly proved true in my boating experience. If we wind the clock back to aforementioned man falling asleep whilst towing the boat, there were three bits of damage. The dent on the side, which I can't really bring myself to go, no filming that, even seen it. This V-nook thing got bent, and that is an indication of the sheer force it must have gone through. But we've got a new one of those at home to fit on it. Note, we have clandestine Waikanae Boat Club and Mana Cruising Club identification stickers and labels on the boat. We don't belong to either of them. And over here, the mudguard. Coming here today, I hooked it up on the fence and pretty much did a good job of bending it. But it took a bit of a battering in the aforementioned accident, and we got a new one of those at home as well. But, like I say, she's a machine, she's a beast. Yeah, so it might sound like I'm nitpicking on a few things here today, but they're only small things, they're all minor things. You know, the list's got 12 or 13 items on it. Nothing that we can't fix. A couple of them are as simple as getting a warrant of fitness, getting a new number plate, things like that. But on the whole, this boat is an incredible machine. I never thought I'd ever own anything like this, and what it's enabled us to go and do in the last 3 years is incredible, really. Like I mentioned, Cook Strait, Derville Island, Marlborough Sounds, fishing the South Coast, fishing the West Coast, fishing the East Coast. We've been up the East Cape numerous times, usually towed by my trusty, faithful L300. You know, they're like chalk and cheese, these two things. I've got people trying to tell me I should be upgrading, but like I said, until they bring out the L500, no way. So anyway, whānau, for me, this boat is more than a boat. It's my everything. It's my only, you know, the amount of time and effort I've put into this boat, trying to keep on top of it, keep it looking good. Major effort goes into cleaning every time. We haven't talked too much today about the performance of the boat. I don't really think you need to say too much about that. It's awesome. There's no sea it doesn't handle. Paired up with a Suzuki 140, it truly is a weapon. And all we're going to say to finish off the review is, you know, I just like to think of myself as gone from a few norms, gone from a few conventions. The life I live is the gone life. So far gone, you're real far gone.